Hello, everyone. Welcome to Random Review. We are so happy you're here today. My name is Bonnie Brzoski. I'm a public services librarian here at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. I'm also the co-coordinator for Random Review, along with fellow librarian Mike Hansen. Today, we're going to hear our final review in the 2022 to 2023 Random Reviews season. This is going to be a review of Empire of Pain, the Secret History of the Sackler Dynasty, reviewed by retired pharmacist Gary DeLander and retired physician David Grube. But before I introduce our reviewers, I'd like to remind you that you may watch past Random Reviews on the Random Review webpage of the library's website, and I'm going to share that link with you now in case you're not familiar. Let me just get that in the right spot there. There we go. We're actually working out our 2023 to 2024 Random Review season now, and I'm really excited for the day when we can share that with you all. Please look forward to an announcement about it, probably in late August. A reminder that the Random Review series is co-sponsored by the Friends of the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. That's an all-volunteer organization committed to supporting the library. We're really grateful to the Friends for their tremendous support. We really couldn't do it without them. You can learn more about the Friends, become a member, and find out more about becoming a Friends volunteer at the link I'm going to provide right now. So I hope you'll check that out. There we go. And before we get started, I also just want to take a quick second to orient you to the platform that we're using today. So to submit questions throughout the presentation that we're going to answer at the end, please click on Q&A, usually in the top left corner of your window, but it's going to vary depending on your device. And just a note that we're going to send a video recording of today's review via email to everyone who registered within approximately 24 to 48 hours of the event's end. Once the recording is subtitled by our staff, it's going to be posted to the library's YouTube channel at the link that I'm going to share with you, because we have so many great virtual events and there are many great recordings there, and I hope that you'll check it out. Far beyond Random Review, there's a lot of great stuff. Okay, so now I'm going to invite Gary and David to join us. They are going to introduce one another today, which I think is really perfect. So I'm going to turn it over to them, and I will see you all towards the end when we do some questions. Take it away.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. I really appreciate all the work that you do to make these things happen and make Random Review as excellent a program as it is. As you know, we're going to be reviewing the book Empire of Pain, The Secret History of the Sackler Family. Before we do, I'd like to introduce my friend and peer, Dr. Gary DeLander. Gary received his Bachelor of Science in Pharmacy from the University of Colorado, and then a PhD in Pharmacology from the Medical School at the University of Minnesota. His thesis was investigating the potential involvement of spinal pathways in mechanisms of drug tolerance and dependence. Dr. DeLander took a sabbatical in Stockholm, Sweden, in the Karolinska Institute, and recently retired after more than 35 years as a faculty member and administrator in the Oregon State College of Pharmacy. He's also past president of the Oregon Pharmacists Association. His research and academic interests include causes and management of pain. And I want to take a moment to wish him again a happy birthday, which he just had a couple of days ago.
Thanks, David. And it's my pleasure to introduce David Grube, no stranger to most folks in Corvallis. Dr. Grube is a native Oregonian and retired as a family physician after a career that extended more than 35 years. He earned a BA in natural science from Lewis and Clark College before getting his MD from University of Oregon Medical School, which is now, of course, OHSU, Oregon Health Sciences University. He completed an internship in Tucson, Arizona, and served 5 years with the United States Public Health Service. During his career, among other things, he was medical director of Compassionate Choices, served on as a member of the Oregon Board of Medical Examiners. And David has also authored several notes on pain management, including a chapter in Lang's Clinical Manual for Ambulatory Medicine. And we are really excited to have this opportunity to share this book with you. It's one that really was near and dear to things that we've been involved with for quite a while. If you look just, if we just look at the kind of a summary of what this book is about, it's really, at least as we see it, kind of a narrative that describes unintended consequences in many respects from an intersection of a post-World War II era in which there were just any number, a huge number of pharmacologic, technologic, medical advances that took place in a short period of time. Couple that with one person's ability to completely upend and revolutionize how marketing took place for medicines, and then how that person's family, extended family, had a single-minded focus for profit and business. And unfortunately, that business had to do with medicine. So it really went down some difficult paths. And one of the things that we realized to our indignation was that there was really a degree of naivete among many health professionals. And those health professionals included your hosts. So, you know, as an educator who taught opioids and who researched opioids, I have to say that as I read the book and saw some of the people that were noted in it, many are my peers and people that certainly were thought leaders in the time that I was teaching about opioids and doing research. And I know, David, you had similar experience as a clinician.
Absolutely. I was a family medicine doctor in Philomath and did prescribe medications, including opioids for patients, and did rely also on some of the articles that we'll reference as we talk about this book. And in retrospect, some of the information that we were given, we thought that would coming from reputable sources, was indeed really just a product of corporate mismanagement. And essentially, that's what this book is all about. Indignation, right? If there's any word that will describe this book as you read it, your feelings, put any adjective in front of the word indignation, whether it's righteous or flaming or whatever. That's how I felt, and I and Gary also felt as we read this book. It just burned. Indignation just burns off the pages. Before we go any further, though, I want to talk for just a second about a college roommate of mine, Dr. Art Van Zee. Dr. Van Zee practices in this very small little town in Virginia, right on the very tip of Virginia where it meets Kentucky. It's a very poor town. It's a coal mining town. He's been there for 50 years. As I mentioned, he's a classmate and roommate of mine in college. And actually, Dr. Van Zee is the person who sort of, if you will, the doctor who sort of uncovered the problem that was occurring with OxyContin. So I want to dedicate this to him.
I'll get back here.
Yeah, we'll go back in a second. This is Dr. Van Zee here, Wayne Art Van Zee. And I'll reference him in a couple different times in this book review. He's not mentioned in the book because it's really not about clinical practice of medicine. But he is the person who essentially testified many times in Congress to get the Sackler brothers and their family to uncover the evil with which they were doing.
Okay. Well, just a couple quick notes about how we're going to approach this. We'll talk a little bit about the author and the reviews that have taken place, and then David will take book one, so this book is separate into three books itself. I'll talk about book two a little bit, and when we get down to book three, we'll probably spend more time focusing on some themes that we saw emerge from the book, those being medical advances that we've already mentioned, unintended consequences, emphasis on patient autonomy, the aggressive marketing, and then this conundrum of secrecy and irony that persists throughout the whole book. So Patrick, Radden, Keefe, really pretty amazing background, I think. He's got his undergraduate from Columbia, two master's degrees, one from Cambridge in international relations and a second from the London School of Economics. and then finally got a law degree from Yale, and has written on a number of different topics, but all of his topics really are having to do with investigative reporting, which of course, Empire of Pain is also that way, really digging into understanding what was going on behind the opioid epidemic. The book itself has been acclaimed by many. It received the Bally Gifford Prize for Nonfiction in 2021. And the reviews of it have been pretty consistent. So for coming from the Boston Globe, it really notes that it is a American story. I mean, this is a story of a family that came, immigrated to the United States and found their way to, through hard work, initially through to success. Unfortunately, it turns into an American tragedy and really kind of a travesty. And this book tries to strip away some of the secrecy that really the Sacklers tried to continue through everything. Coming out of the New York Times, Jennifer notes that Keefe really tries to stay calm through this whole thing, all the while describing how the Sacklers really blamed people with addictions for them just having poor impulse control, that it was the patient's weakness, not theirs. And so they're doing this all the time, being blind to their own lack of impulse control as they continue to seek profits while hurting people. Coming out of the Washington Post, again, writing this while trying to keep your frustration at the fact that holding the Sacklers responsible, or at least finding some degree of remorse for their actions, seems almost impossible. And here in the Reddit notes, you know, during bankruptcy hearings, many members who had deceased family members tried to speak, hoping maybe for some kind of closure, including one woman who had lost her brother, and she didn't even get to make her speech because the judge intervened and said, well, maybe this is inappropriate to really hold the Sacklers responsible for these kinds of things. So a real level of frustration there that persists through this entire opioid epidemic and the role of Sacklers in it. There are some, comments that are less supportive, I guess. And this one from the Los Angeles Times notes that Keefe really doesn't make a lot of space to talk about the lives of individuals and families and how they were impacted by the opioid epidemic. And I think that's a valid critique, but one also has to imagine that understanding the depth of this epidemic and the effect that this drug has had through one or two stories would be extremely difficult. And so we kind of thought that maybe Keefe had a bigger fish, I guess, to put forward in this. And I'll just read this quote from Chesterton. It says, "We've often sneered at the superstition and cowardice of medieval barons who thought that giving lands to the church would wipe out the memory of their raids or robberies. Modern capitalists seem to have exactly the same notion, with this not unimportant addition. In the case of the capitalist, the memories of the robberies really is wiped out." And so we think it's Keefe's hope in writing this book that somehow we can avoid that, that the memory of these robberies will not be wiped out, and instead we can learn something going forward. And so with that, I think it's time to meet the Sacklers.
So this is the three brothers, Raymond, Arthur, and Mortimer. I'm going to spend talking about Arthur. He was in the first book, as Dr. DeLander said, and they were the first generation sons of a Jewish family of Isaac and Sophie. And their legacy gift that Isaac wanted, and we're going to come back to this many different times, is it was quoted in, "What I have given you is the most valuable thing a father can give, a good name." So the patriarch, and I would say if there was ever a patriarch, it's Arthur Sackler with a capital P. He was, as was quoted in the book, as being of singular vigor, a roving intelligence and inexhaustible ambition. And he recognized early on that education would be his path for success. So even beginning back in high school, he figured out that the best thing that he knew how to do was sell things to people. And when we get done reading with our review of the book, you'll probably agree that he knew how to sell things. But he also was sort of told he was going to be a doctor. And so that's what he did. He did his pre-med at NYU, but also there, while he was at NYU, he did all kinds of other jobs, sold newspapers, worked in stores. This is an amazingly energetic fellow. He went to medical school, and while he was there, he was a copywriter working for a German pharmaceutical company, ironic as a Jewish person working for Schering. And as another thing that we're going to have in this review is everything is a secret. So his marriages were a secret. You'll learn later of other family secrets. He wanted to be a psychiatrist, and so he did his internship and residency in a psychiatric center, infamous psychiatric center in New York City called the Creedmoor Psychiatric Center, which was way over, there were, I think it was made for 4,000 patients and it had 6,000 patients. And at that time, there were no really good medications for psychiatric care. And so he didn't really want to continue the main focus of electroshock therapy. So he started experimenting on patients. Now, the author doesn't really explain very much about this, but I can't imagine that these were anything more than experiments, not double-blind control as or with patient-informed consent. But anyway, he wrote over 100 scientific papers. I don't know where they were published, but he did a bunch of these histamine experiments on his patients and then involved his two brothers, his two younger brothers, which Dr. DeLander will talk about it in just a minute. But he also got involved in an advertising department business, which became one of his fortes. This was a time, right, as Dr. DeLander said, right after World War II, where pharma changed to big pharma. Pharma being, in prior to all of these different medications, they would make chemicals, but then they began to make medications. The penicillin was one of the first ones. It didn't have a patent. But by 1950, pharmaceutical companies were making new drugs, which they called ethical drugs, and they released one every single week. So during this time, Arthur became employed at the William Douglas McAdams Agency, which is an advertising agency. He ultimately rose to be the president of this, amongst everything else that he was doing. And he devised these marketing campaigns that were incredibly aggressive, eye-catching ads, making up phrases like broad spectrum in regard to antibiotics, which I had always thought was a more academic term, but it was actually an advertising term. And he had convinced Pfizer, a pharmaceutical company, to make their sales force increase. And within 7 years, they went from 8,000 pharmaceutical representatives to over 2,000. All of this, he declared, was not advertising, it was education. That's another thing. There's a side story, so many side stories in this book. There's another company, he was working at McAdams, and there was another company that was made, the L.W. Froelich Advertising Agency. And as we go through the book and we find some secrets, it turns out that he had employed Froelich earlier, and then he ended up owning Froelich, but nobody knew that. So while these were in competition, the two different advertising agencies were in competition, they were actually owned by the Sacklers. It was really insidious and terrible. And they began then to start doing things like native advertising, which was giving ads that looked like editorial content. And the New York Times, unfortunately, would print some of these. And then finally, in 1950, using his money, Arthur's money, he and his brothers bought Purdue Frederick, which was a small little teeny pharmaceutical company that made essentially earwax removal and constipation medications. He then began advertising and helping out another pharmaceutical company called Roche. And at that time, there was a medication that had been invented. It was a minor tranquilizer called Miltown. But in about 1960, or right before that, Roche invented, a chemist invented Librium. And in 1960, it was illegal to advertise medications to consumers, but Arthur knew how to figure out a way to get around that. And here's the story that was just amazing. He found a story about a ferocious lynx in the San Diego Zoo. And so he convinced someone to write an article about it. And then it planted it in Life magazine, which at that time was probably the largest magazine in the US. And talked about how this ferocious lynx used Librium, and that became a very calm lynx. And it was all with all kinds of pictures. And then made sure that the author wrote that soon this medication will be available for the human population. Then Roche went ahead and started advertising this. And within 1 year, physicians in the US were writing 1.5 million prescriptions every month for Librium. And then he went on and started advertising for Valium, which is another, these are addicting medications. Both Librium and Valium have the potential for addiction. They're minor tranquilizers or anxiolytics. They stop anxiety. And one of the quotes from the book that I thought was interesting was that one of the great attributes of Librium and Valium is that they can be prescribed by any specialty. So it doesn't just have to be a surgeon or an obstetrician or a pediatrician or a family doctor. Anyone can prescribe these. And many, many doctors did. I've written here, I was going to do some quotes, but in the interest of saving time, I'm not going to do that. He also then started this magazine, which I remember receiving. It was a free magazine that we got once a month, I think, in the office, which I actually, back in the day, thought was a sort of a kind of interesting magazine. But it, essentially what it really was a opportunity for his advertising agency to advertise their drugs, or I should say, educate physicians. And this is where they began to make sure that they never had anything on any of these medications that would reference addiction or abuse, particularly these benzodiazepines that were addicting. So the original house of Sackler was built not on OxyContin, as we're going to get to, but on Librium and Valium. And Arthur Sackler always had kept that a secret, as he did everything else. They would do this aggressive advertising. This is an example of an antibiotic that was that more and more physicians were using this, but in reality, they had 8 physicians who were using were in the article. And when a investigative reporter investigated it, none of these physicians actually even existed. They were all a product of Arthur Sackler's advertising agency. This fellow, and there, another thing about this book is there's all kinds of people who come in and out and end up in nefarious ways being sucked in by the Sacklers. This was the head of the Division of Antibiotics in the Federal Drug Administration. He ultimately became a lackey for the Sacklers. I'll just go to the last line, which said that he was making, working for the FDA, he was making $17,500 a year. But between 1953 and 1960, the Sacklers paid him $300,000 for writing articles that were supposedly associated with the FDA. And he, like many others you'll hear in this book, resigned in disgrace. Arthur Sackler also became then a hoarder, and he started hoarding things. And I don't know why, and the author doesn't really say, but he started hoarding art, and particularly Chinese art. And he actually had the largest private collection of Chinese art ever assembled. And then he started giving this to different institutions, but always making sure that the Sackler name was on these. So there were the Sackler wing of Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Sackler Fund, the Sackler Collection. Which is kind of ironic because all the things that they were doing pharmaceutically were secret, but everything that they were doing publicly and under the guise of philanthropy was public. biggest example was the Dendur Temple at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. It was a big temple that was they were trying to find a home for. Even Dwight David Eisenhower intervened in this. Arthur gave the Metropolitan Museum of Art a dangle, which means he gave him $100 million to put this up, but there were always strings attached. He wanted to be on the board. They never allowed him to be on the board because they said he had all the charm of a dollar sign. So it goes on and on. And this book, page after page, is rife with indignation as you read it. He had three wives, but he always kept relationships with the previous two. His marriages were secret. He got estranged from his brothers. He got his after his second divorce, he was married the very next day. But for me, another fascinating thing was at the end of his life, he didn't want anyone to know anything about him. So right before he died, he admitted himself to the hospital under a pseudonym, and neither any of his wives or any of his children knew that he was in the hospital, and he died alone at the age of 73.
An interesting fellow. So that's all kind of covered in book one of the overall book. And book two goes on to look at the dynasty. So what happens as Arthur goes out of the picture? And frankly, as Arthur became more and more interested in philanthropic kinds of things, his control and attention to the business really diminished a little bit and allowed his brothers, who is a little bit at odds with, to continue to take more and more of the company kind of into their hands. And once he did die, the breadth of his philanthropic interests, the breadth of the different partnerships he'd had with these different marketing firms or drug companies, and promises that he made were so extensive that it took forever, probably still aren't completely resolved. In the end, the domestic assets were kind of shared between the families of the three brothers. And those domestic interests were the products that things like betadine, things like earwax removers, those kinds of things. So things that were making money, but not making the big money. Mortimer and Raymond, the other two brothers, kind of put their stamp in and said they wanted to take care of the international assets. And this was happening at a time when MS Cotton, the continuous release, MS Cotton, the continuous release morphine, had been a big thing in England, but hadn't really kind of caught on quite yet in the United States. And so Arthur's side of the family really didn't understand what they were giving up. And what they were giving up was a lot, because that was where all the money was going to be coming from. And through all of this, it was finally Richard Sackler who emerged as kind of the lead of the company. I wouldn't call him a patriarch, but certainly he came out of the best in terms of leadership of the companies. He was the son of Raymond, so one of the brothers, but really admired and emulated his uncle. Shared their drive, I mean, inexhaustible energy, but still that secrecy there. And his father was the kind of person who would walk through the office and have easy conversations and just leave people feeling well. Richard wasn't quite that way. He tried and he was very generous, but really lacked any empathy and just really brusque and really protected things. But he was brought into the company by his father as an assistant to the president. It wasn't long before he was just kind of in charge of everything, or at least leading them. So from there, we go into what really is the core of this book and the core of what leads to this opioid epidemic. So this is really a game changer in medicine. Knapp Pharmaceuticals, so a small company in England, had developed a continuous delivery system for release of a drug from a tablet. And this is a small company that Mortimer, one of the brothers, had nurtured and bought for the family that Mortimer and Raymond knew a lot about, but Arthur's side of the family didn't know that much. And Richard Sackler really saw this as a different opportunity. So the domestic side of the companies that they had, It's kind of had some nice OTC products, over-the-counter products, but nothing they had invented. And so Richard saw this really as a way for them to move into drug development. And this was a big breakthrough. You know, the hospice professionals in England really pushed them to apply this continuous release tablet technology to include morphine. Because to that date, if you wanted to treat pain in a hospice patient, all you had was injectables, maybe liquid. Liquid was very inconsistent in terms of its efficacy. And so this was a big move forward. And they created MS Contin at Knapp Pharmaceuticals in 1980, and it was a great success in UK. It really was a very valuable drug for patients with hospice, with cancer pain, to allow them to be treated really more humanely, I would say. Now, in 1984, it moved to the US, and that was an interesting strategy and really was the game changer for Purdue Frederick. So somehow, well, I know how, they were able to begin selling MS Contin in the United States without going through the FDA. And what they said was that it's just morphine. Morphine is already approved in the US. They knew that stricter regulations were coming to the FDA. And knowing that, they just started marketing the drug in the United States, saying, well, it's just morphine. FDA wasn't real happy about that, but by the time they kind of got wind of it, it had been used in so many patients that it would be really difficult to pull it back out. And just to give you a sense of the overreach that Purdue Frederick had, they actually got as high as into the Reagan administration to have the Reagan administration come back down to the FDA and say, yeah, this isn't that big of a deal. Why don't you just ask him for some follow-up paperwork, which is the way it ended up. So this is a game changer for Purdue Frederick because this is a big product for them. They touted that this continuous release product form of morphine would also decrease the risk of dependence because the drug was coming out very smooth, no peaks and valleys. They had no evidence for that, but they were able to convince people of it. Soon it was generating $170 million in annual sales. And you would think that if you marketed a product with this degree of success, you would want people to know about that. But again, the Sacklers kept all their ownership and management completely in the background, and it was almost impossible to discover that they were involved in this whole thing. So game changer for medicine, game changer for Purdue Frederick, but eventually we needed to change our strategy. And, you know, Richard Sackler was no dummy. He knew that at some point they were going to lose the patent on MS Contin, which was generating all of their profits at that time. And so one thing they did is they tried to really discredit generics. So they would print false stories of people that were using, for example, generic sedatives, things like Thorazine, saying that using generics had allowed the patients to go out of control. All of it planted, none of it with any actual evidence. But this was still going to be coming. They were going to lose the patent. And so they started thinking, what else could we apply this to? And as early as 1990, so this is right after they started marketing it in MS Contin in the United States. As early as 1990, they thought about the idea of putting oxycodone in this continuous release product rather than morphine. So oxycodone, this time they're not going to be able to sidestep this FDA. Things have gotten a lot tighter. But actually, this time they don't want to sidestep FDA because this time they want to prove that this is a new product that they can get a patent on. So as they can't sidestep it, maybe we'll partner with them. And so similar to what David was just talking about with Welch, they kind of got in bed with, if you will, the people at the FDA and the person that was responsible for writing the package insert, which gives directions to physicians about risks and how to use medication. Basically, they helped write that package insert, minimizing any discussion of dependence. Oxycodone as OxyContin launched in 1996, and Richard Sackler really copied his uncle and pulled out every sales trick he could imagine. Huge kickoff, hired a bunch of new people to do sales, had role-playing things where they would talk with each other about how to overcome any concerns that physicians might have about using it. An example I think that's interesting is that oxycodone had been available in the United States, but it was part of another product. And so it was actually considered kind of a milder pain relief medication. And so when they brought out oxycodone as a solo product, so only oxycodone in a tablet, they kind of just let physicians continue to believe that maybe it was a little bit safer and not as strong as morphine, which was completely inaccurate, but it worked, and so they just let it go. And then the other thing that they had, and this was something that Arthur had initially developed, was the IMS system. And the IMS system actually, at a very detailed level, followed prescribing patterns by regions and even by individual physicians. So that if a physician was prescribing a lot of oxycodone, OxyContin, they could go to that physician and just drive them to do more and more and more. So it was really interesting how they got this going. And, you know, soon this was all the money they're making, and they're really making money hand over fist by selling this with aggressive marketing, minimizing any risk associated with it. But problems started to show up. And this is kind of a counterpoint between there's a problem and no, there isn't. This anhedonia is actually a pseudonym. So the company claimed they had no awareness of abuse issues until 2000. Anhedonia actually discovered lots of problems about addiction and abuse as early as 1997. And anhedonia was a pseudonym for the secretary of the lead lawyer for Purdue Frederick. So they certainly knew before 2000. Patients were complaining that the drug really didn't last 12 hours, so they ended up having to take more medication. But the company just said, oh, no, this is really just evidence that you're not adequately treating pain. You need to give them more drug. The numbers of patients with dependence, originally predicted to be less than 1%, was completely wrong. But Purdue Frederick said, well, you know, we would expect this because the people that are abusing drug were drug abusers to begin with. They're abusing other things. They're making the safe drug look bad. People really started early and found ways to defeat the continuous release system. So it's only supposed to let out a certain amount of drugs over a certain period of time. But they figured out that if you sucked it for a little while and then crushed it, you could actually inject it or snort it and abuse the drug in that way. But for Purdue Frederick, this wasn't their problem. This was a law enforcement problem. And actually, the victim is us. It's the company. It's not the patients. And so finally, people, you know, attorney generals in states and places like that said, well, you know, we're just going to start suing because you're killing our citizens. And Purdue Frederick's response was to never back down and just lawyer up. And so you might know this person. This is pretty typical. They would go out and find individuals that had credibility to be on their team. So Rudy Giuliani had just finished being mayor of New York, was well recognized, was, you know, thought to be a really successful person. They hired him because of his name and his reputation. And when he started with them, his total worth was probably about $1 million, $1.5 million. When he stopped working for them 5 years later, his worth was about $50 million. And so this is a really common thing for them to do, to identify people in the government, perhaps who had been with FDA before, and bring them on board as a lawyer. Or in some cases, they even brought on board people who had tried to unsuccessfully sue them, but certainly now knew all about the company, they'd bring them on board to be one of their own lawyers. So at the end of book two, we're left with lots of questions. Will the patients get any assistance for dependence and addiction? Will the Sacklers ever accept any responsibility? Or will they ever be held responsible? And can the company itself, Purdue Frederick, survive? And you'll have to read the book. Book three goes into a lot of detail about the, legal strategies and paths that take place once this drug has been such a huge seller for them, and they're trying to protect it at all costs. But instead of going into that detail, we'd really like to revisit some of the themes that were in this book briefly. We think those are a little bit more interesting. And I'll take the first one. The first one has to do with medical advances and unintended consequences. And I just found this to be incredibly interesting. So this is a slide that I use in teaching my students, and it talks about drug overdose deaths, when people are taking a particular opioid or other abused drug. And this really has to do with unintended consequences. And the line that I'd like you to look at is the blue line. So the blue line is deaths as a result of people overdosing on heroin. And you'll notice that in 2010, that line just goes vertical. So it'd been pretty flat, and then it suddenly goes vertical. So what happened in 2010? Well, in 2010, Purdue Frederick actually did the right thing, a little late, but did the right thing, and created a form of OxyContin that was very difficult, almost impossible to abuse. So they revised the continuous release form so that you could not defeat it. And so now that was not available for people to abuse. Well, if you were hooked on oxycodone, you needed something. And so heroin is what they went to. And so it's just a striking evidence of how the change in formulation changed the use habits of people in the United States. The other thing I would note about this, again, unintended consequences, this book doesn't exist without this line with heroin, because Keefe was actually studying drug cartels in Mexico. And in studying their cartels, he saw that suddenly they were being incredibly successful selling heroin in the United States beginning in 2010. And it was that observation that caused him to start backtracking and turned him into looking at the Sacklers and Purdue Frederick and the legacy that was associated with opioid abuse that they really drove. So patient autonomy was another one.
Yeah, so patient autonomy is, and I'm gonna use the next last couple slides here to describe some things that aren't necessarily separated out in the book, but it puts context for why all of this is happening. And the Sacklers used these individual topics that I'm going to bring up to their advantage in order to sell more and more opioids. So the Patient Self-Determination Act in 1990, at about the same time, right, that OxyContin is coming into the U.S., which means that patients are the ones who determine the pain. It's not determined by the doctor. At about the same time, a couple of years later, we started the fifth vital sign. And so that meant that no matter what the patient looked like, you had to ask them what their pain level was. And of course, the Sacklers figured out ways to make sure that the fifth vital sign signage was in every emergency room and every urgent care, every hospital across the nation. They went on with all kinds of aggressive marketing. Here's some donuts that are coming in a donut box that they would drop off in doctors' offices, and all kinds of swag unbelievable things. And as Gary mentioned, big trips to the Bahamas for big prescribers, all kinds of ways to convince doctors to prescribe more and more. With all of this, with this aggressive marketing, and I guess the thing I had not even known about before was this IMS, where I guess somebody somewhere knows exactly how I'm prescribing medication and follows can follow that data. And it was really interesting that in the areas of the U.S. That were very, very poor, particularly in Appalachia, they really focused more and more of their detail men and their sales representatives. And then this direct-to-consumer advertising, and I know you're all sick of this yourselves, watching TV programs and news shows at night. Ask your doctor, is panaceamycin right for you? Patient surveys were starting at the same time. And if you don't satisfy your patients, they can vote to make your salary go down. The Press Ganey is the biggest company of this. The Sackler brothers knew this, and they knew how to convince doctors to satisfy their patients' needs so that the Press Ganey scores would be good. And then probably the worst, and this is again a way in my naivety, a lot of different of these public groups like Partners Against Pain were advocacy for better pain management, where they were funded by the Sackler brothers, funded by Purdue. And I ran into this these advocacy groups when I was up at the Oregon Medical Board, people asking for more and more drugs. Anyway, so at the end here we are, does crime pay, Gary?
And it's a good question. I mean, again, anyone who tried to go after Purdue Frederick, their lawyers just went after them ruthlessly and tried to discredit them, brought it, went through their whole medical history, somehow got access to it, really went after these people. In one case in 2007, there was a success in getting a settlement against Purdue Frederick, $450 million, which is kind of like, you know, a dime in my pocket. And the response was that three people that helped to sell the drug or lead the discussions about that got charged with misdemeanors. Sacklers were never even named in the case. And the result was Purdue increased their sales force. And the ones that actually were convicted of misdemeanors, about 5 years later, they got anywhere from $1 million to $5 million bonuses from Purdue. Interestingly, May 30th of this year, so just this last month, there was a settlement for $600 billion in a bankruptcy settlement that involved 150,000 litigants. Purdue's attorney's fees on this whole thing were greater than $1 million. So you can imagine how much other people spent on lawyers' fees. Sackler can't participate in any revised company. It's going to be rebranded as Canoa. $600 billion is a lot. It's probably about half of the Sackler's wealth. So they're still going to be okay, in case you were worried. And interestingly, probably the profits that are resulted from the new company in selling OxyContin will help to pay off that $600 billion. So pretty ironic. And then finally, we get down to this last irony that Isaac Sackler, the immigrant who did everything he could to give his sons a life in this country, all he wanted to do is give them a good name. And obviously, they've pretty much totally trashed it.
Some resources for you to consider, and these will be on the, so I won't go through these very long because I want to get to your questions, but Painkiller by Barry Meyer. This is an excellent book, and it's a lot about my friend Art Van Zee. Dreamland, which was done as a random review by Steve Gallen a few years ago by Sam Canones. It's about the social, cultural components of the opioid epidemic. Dope Sick by Beth Macy, which is both an excellent book, plus also a TV drama. And then recently at The Dark Side, and also you can get it on Netflix for nothing, is All the Beauty and the Bloodshed, which is about an artist, Nan Golden in New York, and her addiction and how she and her friends essentially were big players in bringing the Sacklers down. So that's pretty much our review. I've got a million more things to say, but we'll answer some questions.
Great, thank you. That was really interesting. It's fascinating. And this would be a good time, everybody, to submit your questions if you haven't already. We do have a comment. Chris says this should be sold as a box set with Demon Copperhead. So Demon Copperhead by Barbara Kingsolver, if you haven't read it.
I might, if you know about Demon Copperhead and you read the acknowledgments, Barbara Kingsolver got all of her knowledge about the opioid part from Art Bensey. That's in the acknowledgments of that book.
Oh, how interesting. Wow. Great. And then Richard says, would a better description of the book be outrage or incompetence? FDA, Judge Drain, lawyers.
Pick a bad word, yeah. It's appropriate.
Brooke asks, has there been a change in the way that pharmacy salespeople approach physicians, or any change in the kind and level of benefits offered physicians by pharmacy salespersons?
There has been a big change. There have been a lot of laws that have come out or guidance from boards of pharmacy, certainly, that describe the kinds of, swag or interactions or what would it be, incentives mm-hmm. that drug companies can use to try to influence prescribing. So that has changed a lot, probably over the last decade, I'd say.
Yeah, I think that that's true. Long ways to go, though.
Great, thank you. Michelle asks, where are the Sacklers now?
Well, Richard lives in Texas. They all live in either on their own private island or somewhere there. Richard is living in Texas. And again, I was recently reading an article about him, absolutely no remorse. You know, it's the drug abuser's problem. He just provided a wonderful medication for cancer pain. So I know he lives in Texas.
I'm not sure the others. I imagine some of them may be in Europe because Mortimer was more of a European guy at the end. Again, their lack of remorse or empathy in book three, you'll discover that, you know, they're bemoaning the fact that they may have to sell their island to take care of all this stuff.
Thank you. Dana asks, are there any references you would suggest that focused on treatment equity and impact on communities of color?
I don't have anything specific that would do that.
I don't either. Sorry, I don't.
No problem. That's okay. Thanks. And that was all the questions. Feel free to submit more. I'm going to give us just a few minutes. Here we go. We got another one. Carol, are pharmacy and medical students exposed to this history of advantage taking of the professions?
Well, I can tell you about pharmacy, Sam. I know that one of the researchers with College of Pharmacy up in at OHSU, so we have campuses on both OSU and OHSU, is really pretty well known for his work to expose the kinds of I don't know what you call it, mismanagement or mischaracterization that goes on in drug advertising and drug pricing. So certainly students are exposed to understanding that they have to evaluate the information that they receive.
And I think that's true in medical schools now more than it was back in my day. We had no information, but I think things like this, and there are other stories as well, not just opioids. And then the cost of medications, also branded versus generic, sort of allows for more conversations, more discussions in medical ethics classes.
Yeah, definitely. Something that really struck me when you were talking about Arthur Sackler and the way he was advertising is just how similar that is in some ways to a lot of the disinformation that we see online, like actually opening like what appear to be nonprofits to promote specific lines of view, even to certain professions to try to get those professions to do specific things. And it's almost like he could see the future now.
I think that's absolutely right. He absolutely was in a terrible way, he was a genius about that. He mm-hmm. absolutely knew how to do it. There's an old adage that I had wanted to share, and that was, some students go to medical school to do good, but leave medical school to do well.
Thank you.
That's Arthur Sackler.
Thank you. Someone asks, some people with chronic pain have trouble getting relief. Is this because of the reputation of oxycodone?
It's hard to comment on individual patient experiences. I don't know that it's because of the reputation of oxycodone. I think that physicians, pharmacists, health professionals recognize that these drugs do have value when used appropriately. And so it's all, at least in my years in practice and teaching, it's always been a little bit of a pendulum where don't use any opioids, use lots of opioids. And so, you know, I think the health professionals work really hard to find that middle ground where they're appropriately using these medications while still having some consideration of patient safety.
And I don't think we mentioned it exactly, but historically opioids were used for cancer pain. Chronic opioids you were used for cancer pain. And the Sacklers were instrumental in making everybody realize they should be used for any kind of pain. And chronic pain is not necessarily a cancer pain. So there's no doubt that the treatment of pain is complicated, and individual stories are absolutely true. It's not an easy path for clinicians and certainly suffering people who have chronic pain to navigate.
Thank you. This is maybe somewhat related, but Ken asks, how has prescribing drugs for pain changed, particularly after surgery? Have we seen some changes there?
Well, I'll quickly answer that, and then I know Gary has some good things to say. It's changed a lot. You know, I had my knee replaced, and I was given many pain pills as I wanted. You know, now that's not the case. There are some strict guidelines on how to prescribe medications, and there's all kinds of new restrictions and guidelines for prescribers, particularly with regard to controlled drugs, which are essentially the opioids. Also, well, I'll let you speak about the ability to see what prescribers have given other patients. You have that.
Well, yeah, now anytime a controlled substance is prescribed, it goes into a database. And so if a patient comes in wanting a prescription, we can actually look and see whether or not that patient is receiving controlled substances like OxyContin. From one physician, from more than one physician, how many from each physician. And so there's an ability for pharmacists to also have some sense of what's being used. And I would, you know, echo what David said, that part of the biggest change is number of tablets that is given at one time. And some of the more recent research seems to indicate that addiction really is driven by long-term therapy. So, you know, I don't know if it's the right word, but aggressive short-term therapy to deal with pain and then getting out is less of a problem than if the drug's being used for a long period of time. So certainly patterns of prescribing have changed, both driven by health professionals, but also driven by the licensing boards.
Thank you. I think we probably have time for one more. Exactly when and how were the restrictions on TV advertising of medications removed?
It was, I'm trying to remember. I looked this up specifically. I think it was 1997 when direct-to-consumer advertising was allowed. Before that, there were no TV commercials about ask your doctor about this drug or that drug. It just wasn't allowed. But I suppose in an attempt to deal or support patient autonomy,
right?
They decided to do that. And I think there were many in the health profession that weren't that excited about that change.
So ironically, about the same time, other addicting things such as tobacco were not allowed to be advertised on TV. So it was kind of switcheroo.
That's really interesting. Great. Well, it's 1 o'clock now, so I'll go ahead and sign us off. Thank you both so much for your time today. That was really an interesting review. So our audience really appreciates it. And Random Review will be back in September, everybody. So we hope to see you in September. Stay tuned for more news on Random Review. Thanks again, David and Gary.
Thanks, Bonnie.
Thank you.
See ya, everybody. Have a great afternoon.